Okay, I think we are ready to roll here. And that's a really exciting thing. This is Easter Sunday, an Easter Sunday like none we've ever had before, and God willing, none we will ever have again. And I'm looking forward to everything that happens at the service today. And I certainly hope that as we gather together in worship, that we will experience in a new way, the presence of the risen Christ, who is always with us every Easter, but every day in between as well. So let us get started. Well, good morning, everyone. I want to welcome all of you to this glorious day of celebration of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. I especially want to welcome those who may be visiting with us from other churches, members of Holy Cross in Commack. I noticed Christine Farmer from Lutheran Church of Our Savior in Patchogan. There are others whose pictures I didn't see yet. So I am grateful for the opportunity to be able to share worship with you today. And I know that we look forward to the times when we can be together with our own congregations and celebrate the resurrection of Christ. Keep in mind that song that I learned many, many years ago. Every Sunday is Easter Sunday. And while today is the Easter Sunday, this is a time for all God's people to celebrate. And it is the hallmark of what Christian worship is all about. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God has indeed raised from the dead the one who was put in death by hanging him on a tree. Hallelujah. God allows Jesus to appear to us who were chosen by God as witnesses in holy baptism and invites us to eat and drink at the table of the risen Christ. Although a virus prevents us from communing today, we gather to hear and celebrate the word God speaks to us in the gospel. For Christ is risen. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, And the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. D? Yes, D is muted.
Okay, a reading from Acts. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Katie.
A reading from Colossians. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord.
You, O Lord.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Red button.
Done.
Okay. Hey, Marty, guess what today is?
What day is it?
It's Easter.
Easter. Oh, that's one of my favorite days of a whole wide year. I love Easter.
Well, Easter is really a great day.
Yeah, I know. I love it because I get jelly beans and I get chocolate rabbits and I get to hunt for Easter eggs all around the house and stuff like that. It's just a wonderful day. And the Easter Bunny comes.
Yeah, but Marty, there's more to Easter than the Easter Bunny and chocolate rabbits and jelly beans.
What do you mean?
I said, well, Easter is all about Jesus. It's all about what God did in raising Jesus from the dead. And that was a great thing that God did.
Oh, I heard a little bit about that in Sunday school.
Yeah, that's a very important story. Here, I've got it in my children's Bible. Do you want to read it?
Oh, okay. Let me see. It's called... Oh, all right, it's called The Empty Tomb. There it is. It was early in the morning on the third day after Jesus died. The sky was pink and red with the first light of the sun. The women didn't notice the sky. They hurried to the cave that contained Jesus' body. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, led the way. Two others, Salome and Joanna, carried the spices to rub on the body of Jesus. They had a very important job to do. When the tomb of Jesus came into sight, they froze. Uh-oh! They had forgotten about the huge stone that sealed the opening to the cave. How would they get that stone to move? The women kept going to the cave anyway. As they came closer, the women could see that the stone had already been rolled away. They peeked inside. Oh, it was dark in there. It was cold in there. It was damp in there. What? It was empty in there. Jesus was gone. An angel appeared in sparkling white clothes. The glow from the angel brightened even the darkest corners of the cave. The women shielded their eyes from the blinding light. "Don't be afraid," the angel said. "Jesus isn't here. This is a place for the dead, and Jesus is alive." "Hurry," the angel said. "Go tell the disciples." The women did not delay. They ran to tell Jesus' friends what they had seen and heard. Oof! Mary bumped into a man, tripped, and fell at his feet. Wait, she knew those feet. A familiar hand reached out to help her. Wait, she knew that hand. She looked up. Yes, she knew that smile. It was Jesus. "Hello, friends," Jesus said. Jesus was really alive. The women hugged his feet and shouted with joy. "Go tell the others the good news that I am alive." Jesus said, "I will meet them in Galilee. I can't wait to see them again." The women had a new job to do. They had to tell everyone Jesus was alive. Wow, that's quite a story. Yeah, Marty, that is really a great story. And it's a very important story for people to hear, especially children. Yeah, I can see that now. It is a story that makes a lot of sense, especially these days when people are so sad. It's important to know that Jesus is alive and that God raised him from the dead. And he has promised to do that for us too. Wow, Marty. That is a sermon in and of itself. Thank you very much for what you had to say. I hope you have a great Easter. Oh, I will have a great Easter, that's for sure. And a few jelly beans too. Bye, kids. See you later. See you maybe during the week sometime. Take care. Have a good Easter. And don't eat too many jelly beans. And thank God for what he did with Jesus. Amen.
Okay. It's time for the sermon. I'm sure we've all had times when we've had a terrible dream, a dream that woke us up early in the morning, one that so much bothered us that we thought about it probably for quite a while after we woke up. That dream can sometimes be very frightening, and we often wish that we never had that dream at all. But having that feeling of what that dream was like, I think we can understand a little bit of what kinds of feelings those women had that morning as they got up very early before dawn. Now, this was not the first time that they had gotten up before dawn. After all, this was the first day of the week. And the first day of the week in Jewish reckoning was always a working day. The Sabbath was over. But for them, of course, it was not just an ordinary day. It was a day unlike any other day that they had ever experienced before, and a day that they would probably, hopefully, never have to live through again. And as they set out to the tomb, they had all kinds of concerns about what was going to happen. They had experienced some really crazy events that had taken place, with Jesus being arrested and put on trial before the Jewish council, and then being taken from that palace of the high priest and brought over to the governor, where he was put on trial by Pontius Pilate, who was theoretically at least the ruling person in that country at the time, the one who had an absolute authority over life and death. And he didn't hear what Jesus had to say. He couldn't accept what Jesus had to say. He had to deal with the crowds that were gathered there, the crowds that were calling for Jesus to be crucified. And so, as we are well aware, he asked for a basin and he washed his hands. How ironic, washing his hands so that he wouldn't have to deal with Jesus. Jesus was taken from there, of course, and he was cruelly treated by the soldiers who were given the job of preparing him for his crucifixion. Then, after carrying his cross to the place of execution, Jesus was nailed to that cross. And the cross was erected so that he could die there on that cross. And after several long hours of suffering, he breathed his last. These women now were coming to the tomb because they had great love for Jesus, and they wanted to be there in order to show their final respects for this man whom they had loved. He had changed their lives. They had been with him now, in some cases, as long as 3 years, like the other disciples who were following after Jesus. They were kind of the women's auxiliary, you might say. In those days, of course, it was only men that had the authority or the permission to learn. But these women were learning at the feet of Jesus, just like the disciples were. But now they had no hope. Now they were not sure what the future had in store for them. Now their whole world had changed, and it had changed forever. What made matters worse was that now, as they came to the tomb, they saw that the stone had been rolled away. And they saw the angel. And then they heard that amazing announcement. He is not here. He has been raised from the dead. What do you do with words like that? What do you do with a message like that? They looked inside the tomb. They saw indeed that the tomb was empty. Jesus' body was not there. What did the future have in store for them? They could only imagine. And whatever they imagined was not good. You can be sure of that. But it was as they were going on their way, puzzled, wondering, anxious, fearful, uncertain about the future, that Jesus showed up and said, "Greetings." Greetings. What an unusual way of starting a new life, a new future, not just for those women, but for the world. But that is the nature of the message that we have as children of God. God has greeted us. God has welcomed us. God has given us a place in God's kingdom where we can live with him and with one another in love and harmony forever, serving him, showing love to our neighbor, experiencing his presence and his power every day of our lives. In these days, as we find ourselves dealing with the reality of death in our world, we need to remember that it is not simply a matter of life and death, it's also a matter of death and life, because we have a life that God has given to us in Christ, a life that will go on forever, that has the quality of eternity, because Christ is with us now, and Christ is there to make his presence known in us and through us. And he's given us the same mission that he gave to those women there as they journeyed from the tomb. Go and tell others, because I am going ahead before you, and I will meet you there. That is a word that we too need to hear, that the time is coming when we will be there at the feet of Jesus, able to worship him and celebrate with him, and then we'll be able to stand up and dance with him in the kingdom of God, where we will experience the joy that God has in store for all those who have known him and have loved him and who now serve him. So today, while we struggle with anxiety and fear about the future, how important it is that we remember that the future is in God's hands always, and that God will meet us there and be with us always. For Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need.
God of resurrection, from the very beginning, you give the church the gift of women as your witness. As preachers, teachers, and leaders, especially our presiding bishop, Elizabeth Eaton, open our ears to their proclamation this day and always. Lord, in your mercy. All your creation praises you. The earth hums, the seas pulse, the stars shine, the galaxies whirl in glorious harmonies to honor you. Let us hear and blend our voices in song. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
The countries of the world experience disunity and conflict. We set our minds on fear and greed rather than on the rule of justice and steadfast love. Build up all countries on your cornerstone of peace. Strengthen and support the efforts of our president, our governor, our county executive, and all others who are serving our nation in this time of crisis. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We still weep with those who weep and mourn with those who mourn. Cradle the fearful, the suffering, and the dying, assuming them of your loving presence. We especially lift up to you all doctors, nurses, personal care assistants, chaplains, police and firefighters, and first responders who continually place themselves in harm's way while serving others. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Bless the creative and helpful service of worship leaders this day, especially as we worship in extraordinary ways because of our national emergency. We long for the opportunity to gather together as your people to celebrate your wondrous love for all of us. Hasten that day. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray with thanksgiving for the new life you have given us in Jesus Christ. We especially pray for blessings on all those who have been healed from the virus and those who continue to heal and get better. We also praise you for new birth, the new birth of Rory Scott. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Risen Lord, you went ahead of us into the grave and defeated the powers of evil. We remember those who died, especially those we name aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Inspire us to live our lives in his resurrection hope, and draw us to you in our final days. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And may the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you. Please share God's peace with your family members there, and look forward to the day when we can share God's peace together again around the Lord's table.
I want us to consider that first Easter. There were no joyful celebrations or churches packed with parishioners. Instead, there was fear and anxiety and crushing disappointment. They had seen their hope crucified. They had seen Jesus laid in the tomb. And now when the women came, they were ready to prepare a body for death, for burial. We know that those first Christians couldn't understand what really had happened, how the world had changed utterly and completely. We're living in a time now when Easter celebrations will not be the same as they have been, when they might be more muted, when in fact we'll even long for each other more because we're physically distanced from each other. In Illinois, the CDC has determined that the peak of the coronavirus will happen on April the 12th. That's Easter. It's not lost on me that the forces of death are raising their strength and their head at the very moment when Jesus was raised from the dead. I think on this Easter, we can sing our alleluias nevertheless. We might be a little tentative at first, the way the women were when they came to the tomb, or the disciples who were locked in the upper room. There might be a growing hope and strength in our alleluia as we realize that life is continuing and that God has a future for us. There'll be defiance in our alleluias as we take a look at death and all those deadly forces and say, you will not win. And finally, there will be joy, the everlasting joy that God loves us completely and has brought us into eternal life. So, Christ is risen. Alleluia.
Let us pray. Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
By your word, you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts. Freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness. Forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God,
we give you thanks and praise.
Send your spirit of truth, O God, rekindle your gifts within us, renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory forever.
Amen.
Amen. As Jesus taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The body of Christ, raise up for the world. Go in peace and share the good news. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Hey, we have an announcement from Vicar Eric that you'd like to share. Wait a second. I'm unmuting you. Unmute yourself, please. Okay.
We are planning on having a hymn sing on Wednesday. So we would like it if you could post your favorite hymn or hymns on our Facebook group. And Joyce will display her talents and play the music for us, and we will all sing from our homes. So please send, between now and Wednesday, send your requests. Joyce will get ready.
You can also send them, of course, to the church email address, office@hopeluth.com, or to Joyce herself in her own email address, and that would be good.
I wonder which hymn will be the number one requested hymn.
Yeah.
I might vote multiple times. I have a few.
All right. It's time for me to stop the recording.